All right, I'd like to call the order the January 5th, 2016 City Council meeting. And I think we're going to start off with an invocation from Dr. Clayton Robinson, the Connection Church here in Lake Forest. Welcome.
Thank you. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, on this first council meeting of 2016, I humbly come before you and thank you for the desperately needed rain we are receiving. May it refresh our community and ease our drought. Please protect our community from personal loss or harm during these intense storms and beyond. Also, please grant wisdom and protection for those who serve us in emergency services, as well as those who work to protect the public safety. I thank you, Father, for those who serve our city, including the city staff and the city council. I pray that as they plan for the coming year, that you would guide them as they work together for the benefit of our community. Thus, I ask for patience, insight, and wisdom, as well as unity, not only for the present meeting, but throughout the entire year. Finally, I pray that you would bless our new mayor to lead us well. And may you bless us with your presence, and may God bless the city of Lake Forest. Amen.
Next, we've got the Pledge of Allegiance, led by myself. However, I would like to defer to Troop 321, who came out tonight, I think, for their merit badge. So I'd like to invite everyone from Troop 321 up to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Welcome.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you very much. All right, next is our closed session report. Mr. City Attorney.
Mr. Mayor, council members, pursuant to previous council direction, the city has filed a lawsuit in the case of Lake Forest versus Stoner. That is the extent of the closed session report tonight.
Great, thank you very much. On to the city council ceremonial items.
Agenda item 2, comments by incoming mayor, submitted by city clerk.
I guess that's me. All right, I want to start out tonight by saying we've got a city motto. It's called Remember the Past and Challenge the Future. So where have we been over the last year We've got a lot of great things going on in the city. If you look at our Lake Forest Sports Park, 82 acres, paid cash. No debt on that. We always have a balanced budget with some fully funded reserves. No unfunded pension liabilities. As a CPA, that kind of rings true to me, so I love that one. You know, our city manager was recently recognized as one of the Orange County's most influential top 100 by the Orange County Register. Have to mention that. I think that should get a little round of applause, I think. You know, we started a traffic commission, we've decreased regulations, we've almost doubled our investment returns over the last year. So you can see where we've been. Remember the past. So where are we going in 2016? You know, looking ahead, one area we can continue to grow in 2016, I think, is in the area of kindness. And later in the meeting, I want to see consensus to agendize an initiative, a kindness initiative, similar to the city of Anaheim, potentially partnering with schools, churches, our community, in the spirit of kindness. You know, I think it all starts with us as citizens and being more neighborly and being kind. And it applies to whether you work in the city, whether you've got a business in the city, you live in the city, even the city council here. We can adopt this initiative of kindness. And it doesn't mean we have to agree on everything. In fact, you know, I'm sure we will have disagreements, but that's okay. As long as we are kind, I think that's a great thing. So as we move forward in 2016, I think we all, the citywide, can use a hefty dose of kindness. And will you join me in being kind to your neighbors, our neighbors, family members, colleagues, even city staff? Second, I want to ask for consensus later tonight to help return Lake Forest portion of the $200 million of unclaimed property due residents in Orange County. If you can see this newspaper article, it was December 6th. Money there for the taking. The state holds $200 million that 914,000 Orange County residents or firms haven't claimed. You might ask, Mr. Mayor, what is unclaimed property? Well, unclaimed property is your money, and it's gone missing for whatever reason. Either someone sent you a check in the mail and it got lost, or there's a dormant account that you may have forgotten about at a bank. It represents funds the state of California sits on until residents or businesses might somehow find out about it. There have been many articles in the state on this. In fact, I might have another one. The state is lazy in reuniting people with their money, but it's aggressive in collecting it into their coffers. This is a little rain-soaked paper, so bear with me. This was from October 19th, the Orange County Register. It says, California continues to battle a lawsuit filed in 2001 accusing the state of doing too little to find and notify owners. In 2007, a federal court temporarily shut down the state's property claims process, forcing legislators to pass a law to fix it. Since the process was started, property claimed by California has swelled from $4.1 billion to $7.6 billion. I think it's a great article, and I want to fight back. I want to help our residents, and I want the city to publish a map of all the unclaimed property due neighbors here in Lake Forest. And I plan to have events around the city to help publicize the money due our residents. So as we look forward to 2016, challenge the future, part of our motto. There's a lot of new services that are going to be rolling online. I'm really excited to tell you about those. They're going to have electronic recording of documents with the Orange County Clerk Recorder. We're starting a Youth and Government Day in partnership with Saddleback Valley Unified School District. We're celebrating the city's 25th anniversary all year, even having a family carnival on September 17th. We're adding another dog park located in the new Portola Park. We're going to renovate the Village Pond Park, expanding special needs programming. There's going to be sports park improvements, including lighting for tot lots, batting cages, and expansion of hiking trails. We're going to continue to receive funds to pay cash for our city Civic Center and Senior Center, which will again be debt-free, and hopefully we break ground this year. We're going to create a mobile app for the Shop and Dine Lake Forest with business directories and coupons. We're producing a video on Lake Forest, promoting Lake Forest hotels and amenities. But last but not least is traffic. We're going to complete two more synchronization projects along Alton and Bronca in Muirlands. It's going to be inner city because Muirlands is in Lake Forest, bringing the number of fully synchronized streets, corridors, to seven. We're going to widen Portola Parkway. We're going to complete resurfacing Alton Parkway and slurry seal residential streets in Zone A, which is north of Ridge Route and west of Geronimo. So as we look over what we've done, remembering the past, we've had a great year in 2015, and I'm looking forward to 2016, working with all my colleagues. challenging the future, because the future is bright here in Lake Forest. Thank you. And now we come to the moment we've all been waiting for, the report from the student liaison, Kaya McCullough, El Toro High School. Welcome back.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Council. Kaya McCullough here, reporting to you all of the wonderful things that El Toro has planned. First and foremost, I would like to congratulate you all for making it to the new year. I'm positive this year will be one of the best El Toro has seen, and that the class of 2016 will make it a year to remember. With winter break being over, first semester finals are right around the corner. Our charters are preparing well and studying hard to get the best grades they can this semester. Winter sports are now in full swing, with league play starting this week for many teams. Tomorrow night, boys soccer plays Paramount at home at 7 p.m., while boys basketball takes on our rival Tribuco Hills at Tribuco, also at 7 p.m. Thursday opens with girls water polo at home at 4 p.m. to take on San Clemente, then finishes with girls soccer opening league game against Laguna Hills at home at 4:30 p.m. Friday wraps up the week with boys soccer playing at home again in their first league game against San Juan Hills at 4:30 p.m., and later finishes with boys basketball playing Laguna Hills at 7 p.m. Over the break, our boys soccer team won the Orange County Kickoff Classic, defeating Santa Margarita in the finals in penalty kicks to secure the trophy. They are working hard towards defending their CVU League title. Also over the break, girls soccer got second place in the North Orange County Classic Tournament and head into league play with 9 wins, 4 ties, and only 1 loss. El Toro's winter sports are having incredible seasons this far, and I can't wait to report to you how they look. To kick off the new year and to have a little fun before finals, El Toro is having our winter gym dance next Friday, January 15th, following the boys' basketball game against San Clemente. This dance, called Lights Off, Knee On, will be a neon-themed dance that urges charters to light up the night and show their glow. I believe this is going to be a great dance, and I'm excited to share with you how it glows. Have a great rest of your evening, and as always, go Chargers. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Happy New Year. All right, we're off to public comments. This is your time. If you want to come and speak before the City Council, you can address the City Council. Any item not on the agenda, no action can be taken on this, limited to about 3 minutes per person. And we request you fill out a request to speak form. It's a little green form. Or is it blue? It's blue. It's a blue form. So you'll see 3 lights, the first being green. After about, there's 30 seconds left, the light will turn to yellow, and then your time has expired when the light turns red. And you'll hear a little buzzer. So with that, do we have any comments?
Michael Peschel.
Welcome.
My name is Bob Holtzclaw, a longtime resident here of Lake Forest. And I like to talk about ethics that we have in the city, and morals and whatever. A couple weeks ago, I received this check back from Dr. Gardner, and it was for his campaign. And the reason why he gave it back to me, he said I would feel guilty about voting for anybody who I might vote for on any appointment or anything else. This is what I call ethics. So when you're voting for something and you receive money, it's not quite ethical, but I guess it's legal. So here's his check, and I'm going to put it back in here, and that's it. Also, I offered money to Adam Nick, and he refused. He said he'll run his own campaign, and he did. He just asked me to vote for him, and I think I did. So that was it. Last thing here I have is, about a few weeks ago, one of you was campaigning in front of Bagels and Brew, and I got a call that somebody was up there. So I try to get up there as soon as possible, but I guess I must have missed you. But fortunately, I got their name on the recall. So this isn't going to work. Also, the theater, we have volunteers up there all organized. If anybody's up there at the theater, we'd like to join you. And maybe we can get some more recall petitions signed. But thank you anyway.
Thanks for coming out.
Heiko Peschel.
Welcome.
Happy New Year to all. Good evening, Mr. Mayor. Congratulations on the promotion. Three items. First and foremost, somewhere around the holidays, got a note from our local waste management company, I think CRNR, saying they would be picking up Christmas trees. They seem to have forgotten a good section of Foothill Ranch in that process. There are a bunch of trees that have been out there since before the weekend that are still out there, and they haven't come back to get them. So somebody might want to mention that to them. Second of all, we're talking about widening Portola. Let's cut Portola through to Irvine, please. Those of us who live in Foothill Ranch don't like paying that outrageous fortune for a mile or a mile and a half of toll road that we do now if we want to take that shortcut. Thanks to Alton Parkway, it's a lot shorter, but it's still Portola, toll road, Portola is expensive. Third item, Mr. Mayor, unclaimed property. I have some experience in that regard, having helped a few friends over the years reclaim their money from the state. If anyone needs help with that, you can give them my name, phone number, address, and I'll be glad to walk them through the process. Under a certain amount, you can do it all online. Over a certain amount, you actually need affidavits notarized and things like that. Thank you all. Have a good evening.
Thank you. Maybe we can join together. I actually have a nonprofit that helps people do that too, so thank you. And if staff maybe can follow up at some point and just communicate back to us on the trees collection by CRNR, not tonight, but at your convenience, I'd appreciate that. Thank you.
We've had no further requests.
All right, that moves us on to the warrant register. Agenda on item number three. All these matters on the warrant register are considered routine and will be enacted by one vote. No separate discussion. Have we had any requests to remove any items?
We've had no requests.
So, colleagues?
Move the warrant registry.
Second.
All right, please cast your votes.
That motion carries unanimously.
Which leads us to the consent calendar. This is agenda items 4 to 10. Very similar. They're considered routine and enacted by one vote. There won't be a separate discussion unless it's specific items are pulled by the council or the public. Have there been any requests to pull an item?
Item 6.
Item 6.
And actually 6 through 9 I'm pulling.
Five.
So that leaves us 4 and 10, I believe. All right.
Make a motion to move 4 through 4 and 10. 10.
I'll second. Let's cast our votes.
That motion carries unanimously. Agenda item 5, minutes of the regular meeting of the City Council held on December 15, 2015, submitted by City Clerk and removed from the consent calendar by Councilmember Gardner.
Councilman Gardner.
On page 5 at the bottom, where it says Councilmember Robinson and Mayor Voigt, I believe, in fact, it was...
Can you give me the page, the...
It's in your... You have a yellow piece of paper?
Okay.
and it's on the white piece of paper and back of the yellow piece of paper at the very bottom in red. See how colorful we are for the new year? We got red, white, and yellow. First white paper and back of the yellow paper near the bottom. Got it? Okay. There it says, talking Tracy Tingley, Lake Forest resident, expressed concerns for the development, location, and proximity of the Music Jail. She referenced campaign donations from developers and asked, and it says Councilmember Robinson and Mayor Voigt to abstain from voting on the project. But I believe she was talking about Mayor Pro Tem Hamilton and Voigt, who are the people who got the money from Meritage. So I don't think... So I'd recommend that we change it from Robinson to Hamilton.
I second that, given that it is merely a request for the records to be accurate.
Where did the red lines come from?
They came from double-checking the notes, but I did not go back and watch the video. I was looking at the notes that I was typing from the minutes, so I could take a look at the video and just confirm that it was Robinson and Hamilton.
And I'll make my motion
I'm sorry, Voigt and Hamilton, correct?
And the motion would be subject to her checking and confirming that my memory is correct.
That's fine. They should accurately reflect what was said by the public commenters.
And then on the second white paper, following the yellow paper, in the middle of the page, again, the red comments, she raised concern Mayor Voigt and Councilmember Robinson did not know what contributions were made to their campaign. Again, subject to checking the thing. I believe it was only Mayor Voigt's. So,
and to reflect that, no contributions were made to Mayor Voigt's on my 460.
She didn't, as a matter of fact, she didn't say 460. She said 496. And in fact, you denied that the 496 existed.
You know,
and in fact, she came back and showed us the 496. But that's not in the minutes.
I think if we just make the change.
No, I'm happy. I'm simply responding to his 460.
No, I understand. I think we'll just.
So, subject to, again, her checking. So, we got it right. So, that's my motions.
So, we have a motion, a second?
Just for clarification. So, motion and second to make the changes and then approve the minutes as they stand beyond.
Exactly.
If there's concurrence with the city clerk on agenda item number 5.
Subject to verification of the video, yes.
Yes.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's vote.
Councilmember Nick, I'm waiting on a vote.
I apologize.
That motion carries unanimously. Agenda item 6, adoption of ordinance number 280 relating to zone change 9-14-4594 submitted by city clerk and removed from the consent calendar by a member of the public, Bob Holtzclaw.
Welcome again.
I'll just make it short. My name is Bob Holtzclaw from Lake Forest here, and I know we're going to have a bunch of people up here saying that they support Meritage, for their homes, and that's going to be built here, and they're coming from Huntington Beach, Costa Mesa, Irvine, whatever. Well, you did this last time with Don Stahl's friends here, and his son was over at Senator Borlaug's office telling us how much he supports the building here, and he's going to have help, and he's got 2 degrees in business and everything else, and that's how come his father got people over here to speak. As far as I'm concerned, all the people behind me can go home, watch some sort of mindless TV, and that'll be just fine, because we know how you're going to vote. Plus, let's not sway this thing out for long dialogues or something. We know how everything's going to be voted here. You don't have to ask the planning people about different roads or the city attorney about something else. let's just have a vote really quick and get it over with. A lot of people would like to go home before 10:30, and I think this is probably the best way because everything is out in the open right now. Okay, thank you.
And thanks for your comments. So I'll take anything from my colleagues? Discussion? Yes, item number 6. All right, I'll entertain a motion.
Make a motion and we approve item number 6.
All right, I'll second. Cast your votes.
Normally, you'd ask for
discussion. Yeah, if you want to discuss, that's great.
Okay. I have a question for the city attorney. And this is a question taken from the city council's ethics. Item 1.4. It says, carefully consider if exceeding or appearing to exceed authority of office for personal and or financial gain. When in doubt, avoid actions that create in the mind of a reasonable observer the appearance of impropriety, ethical lapses, legal violations, or actions inconsistent with the leadership principles. And although I understand it's legal for a developer to contribute thousands of dollars, tens of thousands of dollars for candidates, nonetheless, is it your belief, based on your legal background, that in the minds of a reasonable observer, this might create the appearance of impropriety for financial gain in a situation like this case, which is Meritage having provided $10,000 to elect Councilman Voigt and Hamilton, and Councilman Voigt and Hamilton then, you know, voting to approve it?
Before you proceed, I look at 1.4. Is that what you said, section 1.4? That says to me, states views briefly and honestly during city council, commission, and committee meetings. Out of respect for the time and attention of members of the city council, staff, and public, limit comments on non-agenda.
You're looking at conduct in meetings. I'm looking at conduct in office.
You mean 2.4?
Well, you know, I just printed it out, and it's on my piece of paper. It's 1.4.
Okay, so what was your, say it again, so I can follow along.
Starts off, it's called conduct in office at the top. It's a white piece of paper.
Yep.
It says, each member of the city council, commissions, and committee has a duty to.
Yep.
And 1.4 says, carefully consider if exceeding, blah, blah, blah.
Okay, I see that as 2.4. All right.
Interesting.
I'm following along.
Funny. Well, city clerk should definitely look into this as off the city website. Apparently, he has something else.
Mr. Mayor, council members, there are a few issues at play here. First and foremost, leadership principles, and especially those governing council conduct, are policed by the council. So that's the first important principle. The second has to do with this reasonable person standard. Not to play lawyer, but I unfortunately am one. One of the first things you learn in law school is how amorphous and difficult that standard is. The reasonable person standard can be many things to many people, which is why when you're drafting a contract, for example, the idea of reasonableness is often a term that's avoided. Now, in a general principle or standard of conduct, it can be placed in there. But what is one reasonable to one person may not be to another person. The third issue is that of legality, which you mentioned. So my job as city attorney is to opine on the legality of actions. Certainly everything that has been discussed publicly, of which I'm aware, has been legal. And one of the issues in section 2.4 or 1.4 that's raised is the legality of certain actions. And that is one of the factors that goes into determining reasonableness and the ethics of an action. So it's very difficult for me to assess whether it's reasonable as far as that reasonable person standard, because that standard is, as any court will tell you, an incredibly amorphous standard. Is it legal? Yes. And as far as a lawyer's role is concerned, that's really all that I can opine on is the legality of an action.
Okay, thank you. I had no more questions.
All right. Entertain a motion, or if there's any other comments.
Could we combine? I think Councilman Nick wanted 6 through 9, but I suspect, can we do them all, or are you going to discuss each one separately?
No, actually, if we do it all at the same time, if we can technically, that would be
a
sign.
Do we have any requests for speakers on the other items?
I do have one speaker who would like to speak on items 7 and 9, so Steve Coover.
Welcome.
Hello again. I missed the first chance to speak on some other items, but that's okay. On number 7, I missed last month's meeting, or last meeting, discussing the first reading of the ordinance about building homes across from the sports park. That's the only lot of land left in the city where we could complete the incomplete sports park with a city pool or other types of family-based entertainment. I'm not understanding why there was a decision made to rezone that when really running out of land. I believe Dr. Gardner had requested a map of what lots the city still owns that aren't developed last year, mid-year sometime. I haven't seen that. I don't know if anybody else has, but I think you might want to reconsider before reading this again and possibly turn tail a bit on the rezoning on this. It's the only lot left. There's no place that I know of in the city as flat or as large that could complete the incomplete sports park. And as far as recusing oneself from a vote, the reasonable person standard, yeah, it might be legal, but it is a little slimy. Just letting you know how everybody really feels, the reasonable people at least. That's all. Thank you.
Do we want to hear comments from agenda item number 9?
On agenda number 9, it's approval of a tract map for 83 plus 13 lots. That's 96. When did it change to 96 lots, and why? Are they cramming more homes in them than originally scheduled? Because I was under the impression it was originally 88 lots or 86 lots. This says 96. That's just a question. I'd like to know, you know, what's going on in my neighborhood. So if anybody has an answer, that would be wonderful. That was all I had on that one.
Great, thank you. And just a matter of clarification for, I think, agenda item number 7, maybe staff could address the location of that. And also, can you briefly discuss question for number 9?
Certainly, Mr. Members of the City Council. Item number 7, which is related to Ordinance 281, refers to a piece of property generally at the corner of Alton Parkway and Commerce Center. It is not near the city's sports park, so the location perhaps was misunderstood. As it relates to item number 9, I could defer to the Public Works Director. This is his item. However, the 13 lettered lots have to do with pieces of property that will not be used for homes. It is the common area, a lot, for example, where the guard gate will be, or whatever they're doing with respect to their private streets, and the common areas within the tract. So there are 83 numbered lots. What that means is those are the number of homes that would be built in that neighborhood, not 96, because the other 13 are not buildable lots.
Great. Any comments?
Move items 7 and 9.
Any discussion?
Yeah, how would we go? We'd go 6 through 9.
I'm going to vote differently on 6, 7, and differently on 9.
Okay, we'll start. I'll make a motion. We approve. Move item 6.
Is there any that we can combine? Or do you want to go one at a time? Just a question.
I suggested that if we combine them, we would save time, so.
Which ones would you like to combine?
All of them, 6 through 9.
Let's do 6, 7, and 8, bang, and then 9.
Okay.
That's good.
So as far as discussion, can I start now, or should I wait for a motion to be made on the second and then discuss?
It's up to you.
However you...
I'll yield the floor to Mr.
No, however you would like.
Go ahead.
The original vote on Meritage was 3-2. Although this is on the consent calendar, by default, by operations, I would be remiss if I did not poll it to make sure a 3-2 vote gets recorded once again, this time being the second reading as required by law. I have nothing to add to all I said last time. Again, it is just a matter of polling it so that, as opposed to a 5-0 unanimous vote, what I think would be a 3-2 vote would be recorded. As far as what Meritage did and how they got to be where they are, how they influenced the elections, I briefly talked about that last time. There is enough information available for people who are interested to know more who did what, who said what, and who committed to whom what. Whether it was legal or not, I understand it was legal. Whether it was ethical, you be the judge. The only thing that I want to add at this point is I often hear my colleagues, my three colleagues to my immediate left, I often hear them say that the sports park was built with free money, or Meritage is giving us free money, or we're going to build the civic center with free money. There is no such a thing as free money, folks. I am not suggesting they're con artists. I know they're not, at least I hope they're not. And I'm not trying to be facetious here. But they are ill-informed. They are ill-advised. Let me tell you what I mean by the fact that there is no free lunch. A real estate development is a business. When they pay a developer fee to a municipality, that being the city of Lake Forest, it's a cost of doing business, either dollar for dollar, or $1.20 for dollar, or 80 cents for dollar. One way or another, that cost, that payment to the city hall, will be absorbed in the price of the house. So the home buyer, the homeowner, the home buyer-to-be, will pay that cost. That cost becomes incorporated into the assessed value of the property, on which the property owner pays tax every year to the end of time. So not only that is not free money, there is no free money. If my colleagues had operated a business of their own, they would know that when there is a cost, you incorporate that into the price to the consumer. That aside, this is the worst form of debt. Those who are in finance, such as myself, there are various ways you can raise funds. One of the worst ways you can raise funds to form a company or whatnot is to incur everlasting debt. And this is an everlasting debt. Because remember, for as long as this home is standing and it is inhabitable, then there is a cost. There's an annual cost. So if we didn't pay for it, the future residents paid for it. Now, you can argue, and I buy that argument, you can argue that, well, they came into the city, we gave them a great city, great infrastructure, good schooling, clean streets, and a safe city
for that, there's a cost, and that the new homeowner pays that cost, right, for the sewer, for something that we endured for years to build. I would say great. That's a good argument. They should pay that cost. Fine. I'm not saying they shouldn't, but let's not call it free money. It's not free. The fact that we did not use your tax dollars doesn't make it free. We used somebody else's tax dollars. I hope I made that distinction for you. I hope it is as clear for you as it is for me. There is no free lunch. When a business incurs a cost, they incorporate that cost into the price that you and I pay. Now, either I pay it, you pay it, or someone will pay it. But it will be paid. There is no such thing as free. Thank you.
So, I've never referred to it as free money. What I've referred to was that the sports park was being built debt-free, which means there isn't city tax dollars that are going to pay for that. And I would argue with the economic lesson that that I was just given and say that really the market determines what the price of a home will be. Regardless of what fees might be paid, if someone's not willing to buy that home for a particular price, it won't sell. So it doesn't matter what the fees are. The market drives it. If those home values start increasing and people are willing to pay that because they're paying all of these fees, what that's potentially doing is increasing the value of all the homes in Lake Forest as well. Because people are willing to pay that price for a new home that's being built. Your home that you've lived in for a decade or a few decades now is increasing in value as well. So I look at the whole thing as a positive. The market will decide whether or not the price of a home is the right price or not, regardless of the fees that go into it, regardless of anything that's spent on it, any of the amenities or anything like that. You can build really nice homes, and people do it in Newport all the time, and they spend millions and millions and millions of dollars. And then they'll sell some of those homes at a loss, because it doesn't matter how much you put into a home. The market is what determines the value of it. I know that from my business experience. And yes, if I have fees that I need to try to pass along to my customers, I can try to do that. But if my competitors don't, they take the business from me. That's what a free market economy is all about. So I disagree. I appreciate the opinion, but disagree from that perspective.
So I have a question for staff. Was the financing mechanism for the sports park and the civic center, you can just answer this briefly, was that unique to Lake Forest, or was that something that other cities do? Is that if it is a common occurrence, which I would suspect it is, if we didn't charge developers, wouldn't there be like a some kind of maybe an outcry or something that maybe we're light or being nice to the developers and not looking out for the citizens of Lake Forest?
Well, Mr. Mayor, City Council, as it relates to the first question, developer fees are a very common practice. In fact, it's being used extensively throughout the Great Park. And you might even see Miller-Roos financing that would occur. And consequently, it is a very common practice that is followed by cities generally, and I don't need to embellish more than what the two council members have already talked about. I'll leave that there. As it relates to your second question, I'm not entirely sure if you could rephrase that.
Is it a favor to give developers like a lower fee or no fee? I mean, wouldn't that cry of giving developers favors if you just kind of let them off the hook and didn't require some kind of facility fee to help finance like other cities have done? That's a rhetorical question.
Yeah, I believe it probably is rhetorical. So
yeah. All right. So anyone to my left?
I'll move 6, 7, and 8.
All right. I have a motion.
Second that.
Please cast your votes.
Mr.
That motion carries 3-2 with council members Gardner and Nick opposed.
I'll move 9.
And I'll second that.
All right, a motion is second. Please cast your votes.
That motion carries 4-1 with council member Nick opposed.
And that leads us to agenda item 11.
Agenda item 11, Zoning Code Amendment 11-14-4652, an ordinance of the City Council of the City of Lake Forest amending Chapter 2.62, 5.07, 9.04, 9.72, and 9.188 of the Lake Forest Municipal Code related to massage establishments and the adoption of a fee for massage establishment licenses, submitted by the Director of Development Services.
At this time, I'd like to open the public hearing. And I'd like to hear, if we could hear a staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Members of the Council. I will defer to Ms. Ackerman for a staff report on this item.
Thank you. Good evening, Mayor and Council members. Since 1996, Lake Forest has regulated massage establishments through licensing and operational requirements. In 2007, the Orange County Sheriff's Department conducted undercover operations and exposed a number of criminal violations occurring at massage establishments in Lake Forest. In some instances, the city's efforts to remove these illicit uses required extensive resources from the Sheriff's Department, city staff, and legal counsel. A review of data from the Sheriff's Department indicates that 15 arrests or citations were issued in Lake Forest from the period 2005 to 2010 for illicit activity associated with massage businesses. Due to these issues, the City Council directed staff to work toward a solution that would broaden the city's ability to regulate these businesses. In 2008, the Council adopted an ordinance establishing zoning restrictions for all massage businesses. The regulations included the requirement of a use permit and limited these establishments to commercial and urban activity zones in the city. And these zones are generally located along well-traveled streets or in commercial centers that have the visibility of frequent passersby. Discussions with the Vice Unit of the Sheriff's Department and code enforcement staff informed a view that criminal violations were more likely to occur when a business is located in a remote area in which clients can patronize the business without being noticed. In 2009, California passed Senate Bill 731, also known as the Massage Therapy Act, and under this new law, cities were not allowed to require any land use entitlement or license for massage uses. However, our code enforcement staff continued to monitor the businesses in the city to ensure they were complying with state licensing requirements. The state also created the California Massage Therapy Council, or the CAMCT, which became the sole approval authority for massage technician licenses. So we're talking about the licenses issued to the individual practitioners at these businesses. And subsequent to the passage of this legislation, SB 731, the League of California Cities and a coalition of cities proposed new legislation that would return that regulatory control back to the local agencies. So in response, in 2014, new legislation was established that once again allowed cities to regulate the location of massage establishments and require an entitlement and to establish operating conditions. The proposed ordinance before you tonight will modify the city's current code in regards to regulating massage establishments in generally the same manner as was previously approved by the council in 2008. So we had certain regulations from 2008. The state came in, said you can't do this. New legislation now again will allow us to go back and regulate in the manner essentially as we did in 2008. The regulations that we're proposing limit new establishments, again, to commercial and urban activity zoning areas and require approval of a use permit. The regulations also require an annual massage establishment license, and the regulations would reinstate the operational regulations that regulate the individual massage businesses in the city. The state, however, is going to continue to retain the license authority for the individual technicians. So that body that was created, the CAMTC, still exists, and the licensing of the individual technicians will remain with the state. The report we submitted this evening identifies several benefits to the proposed regulations. First, the new requirements will facilitate the city's ability to monitor these businesses by requiring annual review and inspection of each of the establishments. Secondly, the requirement will provide the city with a mechanism to remove any establishment with illicit activities through revocation of both the use permit, the massage establishment license, or both. And lastly, the use permit requirement is consistent with the regulations in nearby cities, which will ensure that the city does not become a preferred location for illicit establishments because our regulations are perceived to be less stringent than the cities around us. In response to a request from a council member after a publication of the agenda, Sheriff Department data was gathered, and it indicates that during the time period of 2011 to 2015, 5 arrests or citations for illicit activity were issued for massage establishments in Lake Forest, 7 in Laguna Hills, and there was 1 reported citation in the city of Mission Viejo. In addition, the council member also requested information on the number of citations issued for massage violations versus alcohol-related violations. And in general, there are more citations regarding alcohol due to the number of potential offenses and also due to the number of alcohol licenses within the city. The Planning Commission reviewed this ordinance at a public hearing on October 8th in 2015 and has forwarded a recommendation to the City Council to adopt the ordinance that is attached to your staff report. And that concludes my presentation. This has been kind of a group effort, and this evening we have Carlo Tomiano from the City Manager's Office if you have any questions on the state regulations. And we also have Lieutenant Brad Valentine and Jim Wren, the City's Public Safety Manager. And together we can respond to any questions that you may have.
And I think we're going to open the public hearing already. And now we're looking for public speakers.
Alex Palermo.
Welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, council members. I appreciate the opportunity. I'm a former Lake Forest resident and current owner of a day spa in Lake Forest. And I am in favor of this type of regulation. I have called the police department on at least 2 occasions to report illicit behaviors that I know happen from competitors. We try to run a therapeutic, legitimate establishment. And when we opened our doors, there were 16 competitors within a 3-mile radius. And within a year, that jumped. We opened that in 2010, in September. Within a year, there were 33 competitors. And not appreciating that amount of competition, I then canvassed and did research on those facilities and found that the majority of them offered extra services, illicit services, that were not considered legitimate massage practices. I am in favor of licensing. We used to have our therapists with a national license, which was much more stringent. They had to have much more understanding about musculature and that type of thing. I'm a member of the CMTC or whatever that is, California Massage Council. They are less stringent. I wish they were more stringent. My only concern is the licensure cost, that it isn't exorbitant. I would appreciate it to be something so that maybe it discourages this illicit competition, because it just seems to be growing. So as a legitimate business owner, I would enjoy seeing them removed, but also I'm concerned about the amount of costs that I might incur as a response. Thank you.
We've had no additional requests.
So I think I want to close the public hearing at this time and bring it back to the council for discussion. Mr. Mayor Pro Tem.
Thank you, Alex, first of all, for coming in and giving your input on that. Obviously, the public benefit and the health benefit of massage is well known and established. But the fact is that it has a tendency to go illicit. And so I like tightening those up and bringing it back to the 2008 state law mandates. And so the actual therapists will get their licenses through the state still, correct? And
yes, that's correct.
And we're just putting a kind of a location restriction upon them to where they can be established.
We're doing two things. One is the massage establishment license, so that's a review of the person who's going to be running the business. That's an annual permit that would need to be renewed, and then we're also requiring a use permit. So there's a public hearing and notification, and conditions of approval can be placed on the massage, a new establishment.
Nothing further. Thank you for the work you guys did on this.
I have some questions. I was the unnamed council member who wanted some data. And now that we have some data, I'm going to ask for some explanations. So I'm looking at this data, and it looks like when we had relatively few of them, 18, we had 15 arrests. And now that we have 33, we only have 5 arrests in similar periods. So we're doing more and getting less. What's going on there? We have almost doubled the number of establishments, and yet, in fact, the number of arrests has gone down by 300%.
Councilman Gardner and Mayor, as far as the number of establishments, when we look at the statistics for arrests and citations on these, we're focusing on illicit activity. Oh, yeah. When you look at the number of massage establishments, the majority of those in the city of Lake Forest, if not all of them, are legitimate businesses. So you have an increase in the number of businesses and a decrease in the number of statistics, or as far as arrest and citations. I believe public safety manager Jim Wren has actual information on what type of establishments are, what qualifies as a massage establishment. Some might be a single individual and some might be an actual storefront operation. So the definition varies there and what's included in that overall establishment.
Yeah, I guess you're asking us to limit a business's abilities for where they go. And so, generally speaking, I'm not in favor of the city imposing those kinds of limitations. But then we're offering a reason, the reason being these places have a high association with crime. Well, at least with the statistics we're having, which is one a year, or an average of one a year, it doesn't seem to be a hotbed of crime to me. That's with regard to it being, you know, it needs to worry. How many arrests do we have in Lake Forest? 3,000 a year? 4,000 a year? I mean, it's thousands.
It's in the thousands. I don't have the exact number with me here this evening.
I think it's like 2,000-3,000. It's thousands. So one of them a year is happening in here. So I'm not worried that this is a hotbed of crime. Although I'm a little worried. Mr. Palermo says the majority are committing illicit activities, but I guess we're not picking them up. The other thing that worries me about restricting the location the way we're proposing it is we had a massage establishment open up in my neighborhood not so many months ago, and a lot of people, and it's like right on the main street, and you know, it's right there. You can't miss a big red signs and everything. And a lot of people complained to me about the location there because they felt it just brought the neighborhood down. It looked a little seedy, was what they felt. They said to me they would prefer if it were, you know, hidden somewhere, if it were in an office complex, if it were in a commercial center. In fact, their reaction was, I really don't want that broadcast. And maybe the problem there is that they calling it a massage parlor instead of a day spa, or you know, there are better ways to talk about it than massage. But when it's a red bold light flashing massage right on the main street, a lot of people came up to me and said, you know, what can we do about that? So what is there any evidence? I mean, I know you're thinking, oh, if it's in a main street, that will deter people. Is there any evidence that that actually deters people?
Yes, sir. I spoke with the vice detail in great length. That's the unit within the Sheriff's Department that enforces these type of illicit activities. And some of the information gathered from them and their workings throughout the county and Sheriff's Department jurisdictions is that illegitimate establishment such as this tends to be removed from public view. If it's removed from public view, easy access, so a patron can go in there without being seen, that increases that type of business. Nobody wants to go into an illicit massage parlor next to Yogurtland where they're going to run into their neighbors or members from their community. So if it's less visible, more discreet, easy parking, these type of things, so they can get in and get out, those things tend to add to that type of illicit activity. There's lots of other factors when you get into the cooperation of a landowner, you get into the cost of rent in a certain area, you get into the demographics and city muni codes. They all play factors into this type of stuff, but those are all things that they see.
And I know that that's a popular opinion. I guess my question was, is there any evidence? For example, the places that were cited here in Lake Forest, are those places that were in your face on a main street, or were those places that were, in fact, more discreet locations? You may not know that. Or do any of you who looked at that issue know whether or not the citations we have were from more upfront places or more discreet places?
With your permission, I'd like to invite Public Safety Manager Jim Renup to answer those specifics.
Yeah, once again, I take seriously if we're going to bridge the rights of a business, I want to be darn sure that there's some fundamental reasons to do that. That's my concern.
Mayor, members of council, of the cases where citations or arrests were made in the past, the time period of the past 5 years, those locations were essentially off the beaten path. Those were not, you know, facing larger streets or in a larger shopping center. So they would be consistent with less visible locations. Obviously, we can't get into the details of each investigation. However, even one of the number of the five of those during that time period, a couple of them were at the same location, and that location is no longer in existence. And it was off the beaten path. It wasn't even part of our licensing scheme. It was something that ran in a completely different way. So it was not a typical storefront shop.
Okay. Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you.
I have no more questions.
You know, that kind of makes sense. Common sense. So I think it's also common sense when you're off the beaten path, criminal activity can occur. It's also common sense that things like human trafficking occur. Has that been an issue in the illicit activities at some of these parlors?
I have no data to even answer that this evening. I know the Sheriff's Department's part of a human trafficking task force, and it's something that is building in the county and in the region, but I don't have specific numbers as to how it affects Lake Forest.
Okay. So to me, I think the argument is it really makes common sense here, and I don't need to hear any evidence. Any other comments?
Yep. Regarding the state licensing, maybe Carlo can answer this question for me, but is this information disseminated to the city from the state in any way? So there's people operating in town, there's massage technicians. Does that get passed along to the city so that when they are doing some sort of checks or things like that, that they know who would be licensed and who wouldn't in a particular facility? Sorry. It was a state question, but something you might be able to answer better.
So. Very good question. That is something. There is a state database of which approved members of the city have access to. I can go into an establishment and run each individual while I'm there. However, the state, it's essentially a one-way street. The state does not provide information as to which technician is at which location. That is incumbent upon the city to determine that, and that is one of the efforts that we have undertaken over the past few years, even under the way that the California Massage Therapy Council handles business. We still have taken that step to maintain updated technician lists as updated as possible. Obviously, there's a variety of different types of establishments in town, and some of them, one of the things that the Massage Therapy Council created was essentially a system where technicians would pass through regularly and not have stability of the location, which was concerning in certain cases. However, we did the best we could in terms of keeping track where they were. And then when those individuals became of concern, we communicated that information with the Sheriff's Department Vice Unit.
Okay, thank you very much. Maybe from I'm delving off the topic just a little bit, but since we kind of started speaking about enforcement and some of those questions, this might be a loaded question for either the lieutenant or Mr. Wren, but do you feel like we have adequate staffing, adequate funding right now to try to use the word police this particular issue at this point? As was mentioned, with five arrests, I feel that's actually significant. Some people might not, but you know, five arrests could involve dozens or maybe hundreds of patrons, you know, who might not be getting arrested, but if the technician is, then we get that person. I'm using that term lightly with those individuals, but you know, when that person is removed from operation, so to speak, then that would account for, again, maybe dozens of instances. So do you feel like we have adequate funding to really attack this issue, or are we lacking in that area and it's just something that you're trying to deal with available resources?
From the Sheriff's Department side, I could tell you that it seems to be working well. I can't speak to the code enforcement side. I'll have Jim come back up and talk about that. But from his inspections and going into the establishments and having a daily, weekly visits into these establishments to check on them on the code enforcement side, and then when he sees illicit activity, he refers that to the Sheriff's Department. That does not come to, we are informed here in Lake Forest as far as our personnel, but that gets almost outsourced to the Sheriff's Department Vice Detail, who would come in and handle that. And that is split up between, you know, South and North County. And if they need additional resources, then we might bring in some of the deputies from within the city. So at this time, with what I see, I would say we have sufficient.
Thank you. I don't know if you want to elaborate or if you're good. But
I would like to mention on the code enforcement side, this transition is new for us in terms of some of the ability to address this issue is new. To this point, we have had sufficient staffing. And then if in the event we transition towards this, I think we could take a good shot at it and evaluate it. But I think we're in good shape at this time.
Great, thank you. Last kind of question, comment, and this will probably be for Ms. Ackerman. The way I understand it, one of the main reasons for this is to make sure that our ordinance will mirror or maybe even be a little bit better than some of the neighboring cities around us. So is that a fair assessment?
Yes, what we find is there's a discretionary application. So use permit is the one area that's common. So all cities are coming back to this concept of a use permit and a public hearing and having something that can be taken away. I think one thing that sets us apart, Lake Forest does not have a business license as well. So other surrounding cities may have the use permit, they may have an establishment license as we're proposing, but they may have a business license on top of that as well. So a little more stringent in some of the surrounding cities.
Okay, and the theory is that if we don't move forward with an ordinance, that maybe the 17 or 18 that went to 33 could become some astronomical number. They'd be trying to locate along our borders next to some of our neighboring cities. Is that fair to say?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Mr. Nick.
Thank you for acknowledging me. I was not going to actually speak about this. It's pretty much a no-brainer for me, at least. I was going to move the staff's report.
You know, before, I just have a couple questions, but anyone else?
I'll second the motion. That.
Okay. Just briefly, does the CAMTC practitioner license, hopefully I'm saying that right, do they require, does the, you know how like a medical office or a business license in some cities, you know, they make you post that license. Do they have to post those licenses for the practitioners on location?
Yes, as part of our municipal code, each individual license must be posted. It doesn't necessarily have to be in public view, but it does have to be posted where a city representative could access it.
Okay. And so I would support the motion, and if we added into this item that we post them in public view as part of their licensing requirements, if that's not already done. I tried looking for it. I couldn't find that.
Mr. Mayor, council members, if I could direct your attention,
if that's legal,
to section 5.07.140 of the proposed ordinance. I think this may get to what you're requesting. I'll just read the language. Each massage establishment shall display its massage establishment license and the CAMTC certificate for each certified massage therapist employed to perform massages at the establishment in an open and conspicuous place that is visible upon first entering the premises. So I think that gets you to where you want.
Yeah, that does.
Mr. Mayor. Okay.
Great. Thank you. I kind of a lengthy report. So any other comments? Are we ready to vote? All right, we have a first and a second, so please cast your ballots.
That motion carries unanimously.
Which leads us to item number 12.
Agenda item 12, Zoning Code Amendment 10-15-4849, an ordinance amending sections 9.144.060 and 9.146.110 of the Lake Forest Municipal Code related to the water efficient landscape regulations and adoption of the guidelines for the implementation of the City of Lake Forest Water Efficient Landscape Ordinance, submitted by Director of Development Services.
This is also a public hearing, so I'd like to open up the public hearing and receive the staff report.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Members of the council, again, we'll defer to Ms. Ackerman for staff's report.
Thank you. Good evening again. In 2009, the city adopted the current water-efficient landscaping regulations in response to state legislation. The regulations require that projects with new or rehabilitated landscaping be designed with water-efficient landscaping. In April of 2015, the state strengthened the water conservation requirements to further reduce water use for irrigation and developed a model ordinance. Now, the state requires that each city in California either adopt the state's model ordinance or adopt a regional model ordinance by February 1st of this year. A regional model ordinance for Orange County was recently developed by the Association of California Cities, Orange County, and the ordinance proposed this evening is based on that work effort. The regional ordinance simplifies and streamlines the state's complex regulations while maintaining the requirement of being at least as effective as the state's model ordinance. The regional ordinance does not add any new regulations beyond that which is required by the state. The technical changes required by the new regulations and the thresholds regarding the applicability are outlined in your staff report. The ordinance applies to any new or rehabilitated landscaping that requires a discretionary review, plan check, or permit from the city. For example, the city does not require any review or permit for landscaping for an existing single-family residence. Therefore, landscape or rehabilitation of single-family properties would not be covered by this ordinance. On the other hand, some of our major new communities such as Portola Center and Baker Ranch have very complex master landscape plans where we looked at all of the streetscapes in the common areas. And that's a good example of the type of landscape plan that would require review under this ordinance. The Planning Commission reviewed the ordinance at a public hearing on December 10th, 2015, and they forward a recommendation to the City Council to adopt the ordinance and related resolutions. And I'd be happy to answer any questions if the need arises.
So, do we have any public speakers?
We've had no requests.
Great. I will close the public hearing then and bring it back to the Council for questions or discussion.
I asked my question earlier, but so I already got an answer to it, but my understanding is that currently this would not apply to existing single-family homes or residences, and it would only apply if in some time in the future we were to require a permit for someone to re-landscape their single-family home. So that was my only concern. Other than that, I'm good, so I'll move the item.
I'll second that.
Staff recommendation on the item.
All right, any discussion? If not, please cast your votes.
That motion carries unanimously.
Which leads us to discussion action items. Agenda item number 13.
Agenda item 13, annual City Council appointments to boards, commissions, committees, and agencies submitted by City Clerk. Mayor and Council, this is the opportunity. Many of the commissions and committees that the council members serve on renew on an annual basis. Some of them are ongoing, and this is the opportunity for you to make appointments. We can handle this any way that you prefer. If you wanted to go down the list one by one and confirm, you have in your packet the current listing and who serves on that. We do have one current vacancy. And that's on the California Joint Powers Insurance Authority, so no member is selected for that at this time. The others list who the current person is, and you can handle it individually. Just confirm the current appointments if you want to change. Everything is at the council's discretion.
So does anybody want to change?
Yeah, I'd like to change.
And what would their proposed change be?
I'd like to be appointed to the TCA. I'm happy to discuss that. Otherwise, I have no recommendations for any other changes.
As to the Joint Power of Insurance, I don't wish to be there. As to the vector control,
The vector control is actually a separate agenda item because it's subject to the MATI Act.
I was just going to say, as to I want to make sure on that I'm still waiting, right?
That's the next agenda item.
Right, mm-hmm. Right. Okay. Just want to make sure. Thank you.
Any other requests, comments, changes? I guess a question for staff. Has there been many opportunities when an alternate or someone else runs against a designated, you know, the sitting member? Is that a change occurred?
Annually, the council selects who represents them at the boards. So the appointees are at the discretion of the council.
Okay. Well, with that, I'll entertain a motion.
What would you like the motion to be, Your Honor? I can make a motion for everything stays the same, and then we have the Joint Power of Insurance. Tell me which one of you would like to be there. I'll nominate you. We'll take it from there, and hopefully in 1 minute from now we'll be done with this item.
At one time you were there. Would you like that?
No, it's lost my heart on that, so.
I'll make a motion that current board member stay as placed.
That is my motion, actually. Okay, so you're seconding it. Thank you. But what do we do about the vacancy, about the joint part of insurance?
Well, we could actually vote on your motion, and then could we do a separate motion for the joint powers?
Okay, so let's
Yeah, I'm going to vote against that because I want to be I want to apply for the TCA.
So allow me to rephrase my motion, if I may. I apologize, Ms. Tatman. Let me withdraw my motion and enter one. With the exception of TCA and joint power of insurance and vector control, which is a separate item, everything else stays the same. That's my motion. And there's a whole bunch, so. And then we can discuss those individually. That's the quickest way to do this.
Yeah, I'll second that.
So just to reiterate, 2, 4, 5, 6, 7 stay the same.
Right.
Both the designated member, the alternate, which is our purview.
Right.
That's your motion.
Right. Yes, sir.
All right. We have a motion second.
I'll make a substitute motion.
All right. Substitute motion.
We keep the appointments the same as they are.
All right, dies for lack of a second, so we'll vote on the original motion.
That motion carries unanimously.
All right, so we agreed on 5 of 7. So what percentage is that? 28, so that's 74%. So we're in agreement on 74% of the appointments.
And 4-2? Is 4 included in that?
Okay. Councilman Gardner, do you have any interest in the Joint Powers Insurance Authority?
No, I think that's probably best Mr. Nick or Mr. Hamilton.
Okay. And Mr. Nick, no interest? Mayor Hamilton? It's one meeting a year.
Yeah, I'll since there's no one else.
Okay, I'll nominate Mayor Hamilton.
I got on the library.
I second that.
All right, cast your votes.
That motion carries unanimously.
You sure no one else wanted it? Okay. So that leaves us with the number 3, Foothill Eastern Transportation Corridor Agency.
I move to nominate Dr. Gardner to the board.
I'll second it.
I'll nominate Councilman Voights.
I'll second it.
And then I'd like to hear from both of you.
Okay. I have several reasons. Generally speaking, it's, as I've said before, it hasn't been my desire to be on committee because I like to focus all my energies here on the city and not on the committees. On the other hand, the TTA, I attended one meeting, and in the one meeting I attended, I talked them into creating an incentive program, which for all the new developments coming into our city, the 5,000 homes, those people will be getting a free week of use of 241. And the purpose in doing that was to try to seduce people to using the 241, because otherwise we have 12,000 people coming through Lake Forest on their way to the 5. So that was a very significant thing to do for the city on a committee. So I realized that, you know, by working on committees I can help the city. That was also the first time they ever did anything like that. That was quite a major change of minds for them. And I know Mr. Voights has represented us before on the committee. As far as I know, achieved very little. like that of direct benefit to the city. So I think I can be of greater benefit to the city by being on that instead of Mr. Voigt. Also, Mr. Voigt's attendance record has not been good. I was his alternate, and he missed several meetings. One never informed me as an alternate I should go. The only one time he did, he called me like the day before and said, could you go? So, you know, I felt that his lackadaisical approach wasn't serving the city well. So either for both of those reasons, I feel I could do a better job serving the city than Mr. Voigt is currently doing.
I've served on TCA since 2010, and Mr. Gardner, Councilman Gardner's recollection of he went to the a meeting of South Orange County Economic Coalition and talked to staff at TCA, and that was a process that was already enacted. In 2008, they've been working with the developers of South Orange County and Irvine to work on an incentive program. So it was something that was already in the works, and it was been in the works for 7 years before Councilman Gardner was even involved with Lake Forest politics, or before myself was even involved in Lake Forest politics. And so that has been agreed upon by the developers, and it will be coming. They'll be rolling that out sometime this year, I think in February. But it's been in the works since 2008. And so that's something that's been there. I've missed a few meetings in 2013 due to a shoulder injury. Other than that, I had one time where I had the flu and one time where my mom fell down the stairs. And so my attendance record isn't as what it's been stated as. I'm an intricate part of the TCA. I enjoy being on that. Bridge work was part of my career. I worked on many of the bridges here in South County before falling off of a bridge and breaking my back. So I would very much like to be back on TCA. I enjoy being on there. I enjoy trying to get an alternative to the 5 freeway going south. I think it's in dire need that we complete that road, and it's far overdue. So to alleviate some of the traffic on the 5 freeway, when people talk about traffic in South Orange County, it's not really in our city streets that we're being inundated with traffic. It's usually on our thoroughfares on the 5 freeway going south. And so I think that it's imperative to commerce, to the tourist industry, whether you land at John Wayne Airport and want to spend the day at Disneyland and go to San Diego and go to SeaWorld and San Diego Zoo, I think it's important that we're able to get a corridor that can you can actually travel on. On the weekends, you can get on the 5 freeway going south and sit for an hour before you hit the county border line. So it's important that we get an alternative south on the 5, an alternative to the 5. So I seek reappointment.
I just have to interrupt because Mr. Voigt once more has strayed from the truth, and it's getting pretty disturbing to me for all the times that you can't seem to tell recollect the truth. Either you don't remember things or you have a problem. Mr. Voigt claims that I've...
Since 2008.
Do you want to...
2008. Yeah,
let's... Mr. Voigt claims that, you know, I found out about it at the South Economic Coalition meeting and that I wasn't involved in it. In fact, that's false. I was involved in it, and you can speak to the man in charge, and he announced it at that meeting that I was there. And when I went up to him afterwards, he said, oh, you're the guy that did it. And then he called everybody over and said, yeah, this is the guy who started it. So in fact, that was my initiative. It was my first and only meeting at the TCA, and it only came up later because he announced it at that South Economic Coalition. And just in case, you're stretching the truth, so another reason I don't particularly want to see Mr. Voigt on a committee or a council representing us is he seems to have difficulties with the truth. And I think that reflects badly on our city. At the last meeting here, he did the thing with the 496. We all know what that was. I don't need to go through that. He did the thing with the I did not wear a wire. And there are so many instances, it's actually embarrassing, and I'd rather not have Mr. Voigt's out there representing my city and embarrassing me with this kind of continual, almost never-ending stretches of the truth. So, amen.
So on the leadership principles, 1.5, it does say refrain from abusive conduct, personal charges, or verbal attacks upon the character, motives, ethics, morals, or comments of other members of the council. So it seems like it's not abusive, it's not personal charges, but there you are attacking his character, which is in our leadership principles something that it says to refrain from.
I would believe I'm describing his character, not attacking it. If I was attacking it, I'd say, "You dirty, rotten liar," and that I wouldn't say. But if okay. I said that, I would say that's attacking his. To characterize him as a person with challenges, I have here, if you'd like it, it's a list of his deviations from the truth. Now, that's not an attack. That's a description of his behavior. And I wasn't going to bring that up. I was going to let it pass until he did it again.
Well, I just read the leadership principles, so let's move on.
Call for the vote.
What are we voting on?
Voting on, I guess we're voting on your nomination of me.
Okay, great.
Did you motion?
Yeah, the substitute motion comes first, and the substitute motion is for Mayor Pro Tem Voits to be the appointee.
So that's what we're voting on then?
Correct.
I think I asked. Okay.
So, any other discussion? Let's vote.
That motion carries with Councilmember Gardner and Councilmember Nick opposed.
Okay. On to agenda item number 14.
Agenda item 14, appointment to the Orange County Mosquito and Vector Control District pursuant to the MATI Act submitted by City Clerk. And Mayor and Council, this item is for the appointment to the Orange County Vector Control Board. It is at the Council's discretion as to whether or not the appointee serves 2 years or 4 years. So when making your motion, I would need you to decide if you wanted a two-year term or a four-year term. It is at the Council's discretion. And two applicants submitted letters of interest, Mayor Pro Tem Voits and resident Bob Holtzclaw. Mr. Holtzclaw is in the audience tonight. He did submit a request to speak. And I'd be happy to answer any other questions you have about the appointment.
Great. I think now's your time. Would you like to come and speak on this item? Again, welcome.
Yeah, welcome. Thank you. My name is Bob Holtzclaw, and I'm applying for the job for Vector Control. I've been interested in this because I do a lot of work with the growers here in Orange County. I also have a coffee plantation in Puerto Rico, and we also invite Vector Control to some of our meetings of the rare fruits growers, and we work with them also for the Department of Agriculture. I'm very aware of the two rats that we have, the root rat, roof rat, and the long-eared rat that we have, which is normal here in Southern California. The other one actually comes from China. Also, our mosquito problems, so we also deal with that ongoing. That's why I feel I'm probably the best person for this job, because I've been doing this for years. Not just going to a meeting and turning out something that I got a leaflet on. Matter of fact, the leaflet on the yellow fever mosquito, I got that from Marcia Rudolph years ago. She asked me, "Does your group know about this?" And I says, "Yes, we've done it because we've had Vector Control all the time talking to us about these things." So I just want to let you know my background. I've done this for many years. I'm very familiar with the rodents in the area, and also the insects, mosquitoes, anything else. But I'll leave it up to you how you feel about this vote. And if you want someone who is knowledgeable, I'm your person. Thank you.
I have a question for Mr.
No, I was just going to say, hey, thanks for applying. Anytime anyone applies, you're trying to volunteer your time and your efforts, so thank you for applying.
Thank you.
Yeah, I have a question. Well, as a matter of fact, pursuant to Mayor Hamilton's comments, I have a quote here from Scott Voigt's campaign literature. He says, as your city councilman, Scott will not only serve your interests, but will invite citizen participation. So from Scott Voigt's, thank you very much for participating. Now, at the last meeting, it was pretty obvious to me that although he has some interest in this area, that you were far more qualified. On the other hand, my colleagues, Mr. Robinson, Mr. Hamilton, they preferred Mr. Voigt's, amongst other reasons, because they felt that he understood budgets and that he understood the pension spiking issues and that you were unaware of those issues and therefore they preferred having Mr. Voigt's, but they never gave you an opportunity to talk about that. I wonder if you'd take a little time and talk about any ideas you have about budgets or pension spikings.
Well, I thoroughly I disagree with any kind of spiking of pensions or anything else. It would have to be really something that where they're way behind in their department as far as their retirements or something like this. When I first left the government, I worked for Combustion Engineering, and I was also in charge of their sales staff. We tried to keep the salaries in proportion to everybody else's, and we had a budget, you know, for our sales staff and also other employees that we were even with all the other people in that line of work, which is probably the same thing as government. Well, at least it should be. So that's. I hope that answers your question.
Okay. Thank you.
You know, since someone asked, are you familiar with the which pension organization they're with?
No, I'm not.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. I think we should allow the Mayor Pro Tem his comments about the application.
You know, our location is geographically blessed. I talked about that a lot, with the 5 freeway being on our western border and the 241 in this, on our eastern border. But we're also blessed with many opportunities for what Marshall Rudolph would call varmints to populate our city, whether it be the creeks or our open space or the Cleveland National Forest. So the fact that we have so many opportunities for varmints to impact public health here in Lake Forest, I think it's important for us to be very involved with vector control. I think that the concern that I brought to the last council meeting was that the Asian tiger mosquito was found in Lake Forest, and this isn't typically the time of year where mosquitoes are populating and multiplying, but the fact that they found one here in Lake Forest was of great concern for them because of the daytime infection that they can bring because they bite during the day, unlike many of the other mosquitoes in Orange County, which actually at dusk will come out and attack you at dusk. So these Asian tigers are very aggressive and will attack during the day. So I've enjoyed my meeting there. And so I seek a 2-year term on vector control. I seek reappointment.
Okay. We asked questions of Mr. Holtzclaw, so any questions of Mayor Pro Tem? Mr. Voigt. All right, seeing none, anything from my colleagues?
I'll motion to accept Bob Holtzclaw for a 2-year term.
I second that.
Make a substitute motion to reconfirm Mayor Pro Tem Voigt.
And I'll second that. So we'll go and vote on the substitute motion first.
For clarification, the appointment of Mr. Voigt would be for a 2- or 4-year term?
For a 2-year term.
Thank you.
So any discussion? If not, let's vote.
That motion carries with Council Members Gardner and Nick opposed.
Again, thanks to everybody who applied. And that leads us to item number 15.
Agenda item 15, discussion of City Council policies, submitted by City Clerk. And Mayor and Council, at its meeting of November 3rd, at the request of Councilmember Robinson, the City Council directed staff to place an item on a future agenda to discuss the various Council policies. And further, at the meeting of December 15th, Council requested to add a discussion of meeting decorum and audience participation. The City Council's office maintains the Council adopted policies. We've presented them to you tonight and described briefly how those policies come to pass. Any further direction tonight would be at Council's discretion.
So I think Councilman Robinson requested this item. I don't know if you have anything, but I just wanted to mention that.
Yeah, I did. We've had a lot of discussion about some of our council policies, so I appreciate the staff. Basically, what you've done in the staff report was give us a list of all of the policies. I think that what would probably make the most sense would be to identify policies where we want a more significant staff report. That's what I would like. I'd like to understand how our policy is compared to other Orange County cities, how it relates, and so with respect to that, I mean, we have 31 policies here. The ones that I'm most interested in are our written communication policy, which is number 6. Our consensus for placing items on the agenda, which is number 7, and then our leadership principles, which is number 29.
I'd like to add 18, and I agree with your I think this is a two-step process, because I think staff would have been very difficult to provide that analysis that we're requesting for all 31. So I think it's good to identify, I think, the ones that are important to us to request staff further analysis. So I have 6, 7, 18, and 29. Does anyone else Anyone else?
Well, the only comment I can make, as I sit here, reminds me of my first year in graduate school, and they used to tell a joke about Sigmund Freud and Edmund Titchener. Everybody knows who Sigmund Freud is. Titchener was called a structuralist. It's a form of psychology, pretty obscure stuff. Anyway, they were at a conference in New York City, and Freud was going through the at 42nd Street, and Freud was looking in the gutter, and Titchener came upon him, and he said, "What are you doing?" And Freud said, "I'm looking for my watch." And Titchener said, "Well, I'll help you. Where did you lose it?" He said, "I lost it on 14th Street." And Titchener said, "Well, what are you doing here?" And Freud said, "This is the only place where there's any light." So the reason that joke, obviously not a joke, but that story comes back to me is that I think my colleagues here are missing the point. The way we go about business here is the problem. It's not the specific policies. Now, we could do the policies, and there's probably no harm in that. But from my point of view, it's not the policies. It's the way we do business, the way we conduct, the whole framework in which we get things done. That's what, to me, needs repair rather than specific policies. So
good luck making them understand it.
I mean, I'm happy to go to the policies. I see no harm in that, but you know, to me, the to me, the you know, the whole problem is fundamental things. What I call the void, you know, all those dozen plus items that never come back to us, and I'm not sure that that's in a policy, or the fact that we ask for things to be done and they're not done. They're actually not done, and I'm not sure that's in a policy. The fact that we never know what's going on from week to week, and there's no really forward planning, and you know, to me, it's those kinds of process issues that need attending to. And this may not be a good forum to do that, and that may be a workshop, maybe a better place to do that. So I have no objections, you know, and you've certainly pointed out items I'm interested in too, but and I'm happy to go along with that. But to me, there's a greater issue out here that could be dealt with separately from the individual policy item.
I think workshop's a great idea. You know, we're going to have some fundamental differences of opinion with respect to how things are going, and I can understand that. You know, you'll be frustrated by it. I feel like things are going very well. It doesn't mean that every meeting runs well, but it's really the individuals that make up that meeting. I can't regulate independent or individual behavior. I can't. We can try to set policies that guide our behavior, but I can't make you do anything. I can't make anyone in the room do anything other than myself. I can only focus on myself. And so I constantly need to walk into this room understanding that this is a business meeting and we're trying to get things done, but we're going to have a fundamental difference of how things are going. I feel like I have a very good understanding of what's going on right now. And we can get into this at a workshop level, but you know, every week, I would assume you do too, but you know, I get a weekly update in a paper form from the city manager, and on the cover of it is a bullet point of about 7 different items that he's currently working on and the staff are working on, and those items end up showing up on the agenda. Also in this policy, in one of the policies that we have here, it very clearly states that we can be as specific as we want about agenda items that we want to see on particular days. It spells it out in the policy, but we have to ask for that. And typically when I've tried to agendize items, they're not the most pressing thing that needs to get done at the next meeting or 2 meetings from now. So my direction when I've made motions to the staff has always been try to work this in where it makes the most sense. From a long-term planning perspective, I was quite taken aback this past year, when on the very same council meeting where we approved our annual budget and we were talking about strategic planning, we added something that wasn't in that. So we're not using our own governing documents a lot of the times. We should be looking at those things, and we probably even agree to a certain extent on that. And so it's how we do that, really. I want to try to constantly figure out how we can do better at what we do. I want to do that as an individual, as a business owner, as a husband, as a father, as a council member. So you know, I'm very open to the workshop concept, and I'd like to include that in my motion that when we're discussing these particular items. And maybe could we leave it to a little more general discussion? I mean, is that, or how specific would we need to be? And maybe that's the city attorney.
Mr. Members of the Council, I think if there are policies you want to specifically talk about, which you've identified several of those, that's fairly easy to do. If there are areas that you think really should be policies, they're not there, and you want to articulate those tonight, I think that's certainly fine too. But you can also have the conversation, I think, that Dr. Gardner's talking about, more broad-based about your approach. And we'll find some way by which to characterize it, but I think it's fundamentally what was already articulated. And if you did that in a workshop, we'd have fairly broad rubrics on it so that it would give you the ability to discuss the issues that I think were being offered here at this moment. So if your desire is a separate workshop study session, that certainly is an alternative that I think that the staff identified in our report that might lend itself well to the conversations that I think that you might be suggesting that you would have rather than during a regular council meeting. And perhaps doing those as a study session prior to a regular start of a meeting might be appropriate. You might think about that like at 5 o'clock to 6:30 or something when we don't have a closed session or how we could work that around. So I think broad is fine as long as I think we all understand what that means. That's always part of the issue is what was the intent and how does everybody understand that intent. But I believe it's a fairly generalized broad rubric that Councilmember Gardner was talking about. We'll list something to that nature.
That seems to make the most sense to me. So would that kind of encompass what you're trying to accomplish here? And then we can also discuss these four specific policies. And are there any others that I don't mean to be taken?
Yeah.
But,
yeah.
You know, if there are any others, we might as well just identify them now. And then that gives the staff some opportunity to give us, again, what I'm hoping to see, what's included in my motion here. So we can just confirm that it's in the second as well. But that, you know, we're getting that information from surrounding cities. Orange County area would be kind of good for me, but if there's some statewide information that might be somewhat easily available, that could be beneficial. So if that makes sense, but I don't want to take it too broad and make it a complex report to put together. So,
you know, one final question from myself is would it be just a more of a discussion type of agenda item, or would it be action also? What's your recommendation, or does it?
Commissioner members of the council, I think you'd want to have a conversation that's fairly informal, but giving the staff whatever final direction you might have as to, for example, how you might want to modify one of the policies you identified, maybe not trying to actually adopt it that night, but tell us what you'd like to see and to bring that back. And if there is a series of actions that would be related to what Councilmember Gardner articulated, obviously we'd have to have some kind of idea of what it is we need to be writing in order to bring it back to you. But I think your workshop would be an opportunity to discuss sort of all of the issues, try to drive to some consensus about what it is that you'd want to see, and then charge us with coming back to you at a future meeting then to take the final action.
Good.
Yeah, I think it's a good idea, and I think some of these things may act as what I'm calling process variables, may resolve themselves out in the dealing with the details, and then that may focus for us even better what the remaining process variables are that haven't been accounted for when we've gone through each of these individual policies. I think it's a good idea.
All right, we have a motion. I can't remember if we have a second.
Second.
All right, motion and second.
What was the motion about, Andrew?
It was keeping a broad, open-ended conversation and on some of the items that could be discussed.
Right.
I think Dr. Jim Gardner, Councilman Gardner, sorry, mentioned some of those, and also staff was going to come back and provide more research on policies numbered 6, 7, 18, and 29.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.
And Mr. Mayor, if I could, I think it was the sense and perhaps the maker and the second of the motion that you'd be doing this as a study session, date to be determined.
Yeah.
I know that this is an important discussion, so just in general terms, I mean, what kind of time frame would make the most sense for you and the staff, recognizing you've got, you know, some research to do here?
Yeah, not the next meeting. That'd be kind of difficult
that.
To do. So probably in the month of February. What we'd really want to do is look at if we have closed sessions that ordinarily start at 5:30, try to ensure that we can perhaps work all of those issues in within the time frame. But we'll put it on as soon as we can. And we'll give you perhaps then an updated sort of status report as where we're at on some of that research in terms of when we might be bringing it back. But certainly our goal would be to try to bring it to you in the month of February.
Okay, that's acceptable to me and to the second.
Yes.
Okay. Any discussion? If not, let's cast our votes.
That motion carries unanimously.
All right, that leads us to the city manager's report.
Thank you, Mr. Members of the Council. Actually, I'm going to ask Mr. Wheeler to say a few things. This clearly is the really first storm in the El Nino season. I was out driving around the community today looking at how our conditions were faring. But I'd like him perhaps, with your indulgence, to perhaps give us an idea of how we're doing out there, given the conditions that I think we saw today and perhaps that we might see over the next few days. And clearly through the El Nino season, I know we've been trying to weatherize ourselves really well. So, Mr. Wheeler, if you could just take a minute or two to tell us how well we fared today, I think I would appreciate it. I'm sure the audience would well.
Thank you, Mayor, members of the Council. We fared well today on the first big storm. We had some spot flooding. We had some catch basins that clogged. Our public works crews were on a normal patrol. During the rainstorms, they know where all the hot spots are, so we routinely go through there, clear out the catch basins. Had a couple things that we fixed today. We did have the crane out. We actually used a different crane this time. It's actually a long excavator down off Lake Forest Drive, and for the Kanata Grate to remove the debris that comes down that creek and clogs that to prevent any flooding on Lake Forest. Most of the development construction sites were fine. Did have an incident on the southern port of the Portola Center development on the side closer to Aliso Creek over by El Toro Road. A little bit got off site there through their mitigation area. There's a lot of flows there. All the city property worked really well. We spent some extra time and effort getting ready for that, so that all went well. The county did announce a voluntary evacuation in Silverado Canyon in the burn areas, so that could be changed to mandatory evacuations. But it's not in our city, but could affect things going down through the canyon. So be careful there. Other than that, we're in pretty good shape. We're monitoring it, and we'll see. As the big fear is, of course, when the soils get saturated through the course of the week. But in terms of flood control and stuff, we're in pretty good shape so far.
Great. Any city attorney comments? I guess that goes to council. Councilman Gardner.
Happy New Year to everybody, and thank you to our brave, dedicated dozen here. Thank you for staying. We're going to get out of here at 9 o'clock. It was a good meeting. Thank you, Mr. Hamilton, for having a good meeting without incident. It went pretty well, even though I lost 3-2 most of the time. Still, it was a good meeting. Keep in mind, this month we have the new business reception later on, I think in about a week time, and that's always pretty exciting. And of course, Snowfest, that's one of our premier events, so all of that coming up in January. I had two items I wanted to raise for future meetings. The one is, I recently learned, just to back up slightly, my colleagues told the staff to stop studying animal care alternatives to using the county, and that was directed to the staff, but of course they can't stop me, so I have been very busy working on that project with about a dozen people in the community. And in the course of doing that, we wanted to get some information about what's actually happening, that we're actually paying for. And it turns out we have no idea what we're actually paying for with Orange County. You know, the detail stuff. They send us a bill, give us $200,000, give us $300,000, et cetera, et cetera. But when you say, and they say, well, we picked up 200 dead animals and we did 900 stray animal reports, blah, blah, blah. But those actual details, we really don't have those details. So we've been paying money without the details. So I'm going to, and the other thing, I wanted minutes on that FOAB meeting. Apparently, there are no minutes. Neither does the county have the meetings, nor do we have meetings. So I'd like to agendize for the future so the staff can have some guidance from us, what we want back from them in the animal care. And I'll remind my colleagues who said that sticking with the county, we'd be asking them for more accountability. I think this would fall well inside that line. So I'm going to ask for consensus to bring back a discussion of the billing and the FOA meetings from Arnold.
You surely have mine, but...
Do I have anything else? Going.
So you want details on what we're being billed for?
Yeah, in other words, if you say we picked up 300 animals, mm-hmm. And the reason I raise this comes up, when we did that study of the euthanasia, we found out that, in fact, the data they used for euthanasia was wrong. When Randy Johnson did that study on compliance, we found out their compliance data was wrong. So, you know, if they're wrong about compliance, if they're wrong about euthanasia, why wouldn't we assume that they're wrong about the way they bill us? That they only looked at 400 stray animals, but they billed us for 900 stray animals. So, you know, I'd like to nitty-gritty, and I've asked through public information to get that information, which I'm entitled to do, but I think it would be good if the council, given that your desires to stay with the county but hold them more accountable, if we up the ante, that in fact we see, you know, what we're actually paying for.
Do we actually have any of this data?
We get our billing statement that gives us summary data. So we're on our bill, it shows how many animal charge days we're charged for, and that's how they calculate the dollar amount. But we do not get backup that substantiates that. Like, we don't get an intake form or anything like that that would show this is the information that supports those animal charge dates, for example.
Okay. And that's your...
Well, you know, ordinarily you'd say, well, but given that the only two things I looked at from Orange County were euthanasia, and they were wrong, and compliance, and they were wrong. So now I'm assuming we should be looking at the finances, too.
Okay, so it's billing, and the other was FOA?
Yeah,
I don't know the acronym, so.
FOAB? Yeah, FOAB.
Okay, and?
Can you say, do you know what the FOA, I was?
Financial.
It's the Financial Operational Advisory Board, and it's a board that is appointed by the Orange County City Managers Association to advise the Orange County City Managers Association about the operations and financial issues at the animal shelter.
Okay.
Or the whole operation.
And are they a Brown Act?
They're not a Brown Act committee. There are no minutes of those meetings.
Okay.
Yeah, but we could have minutes. In other words, our representative could come back to us and say, this is what they're discussing. So we can create minutes. Well, that's the purpose of bringing it back for us to discuss. Do we want that or do we not want that?
Okay. I'm fine with that. I'm not really sure what, you know, they're going to come back with. So right now, just on the billing part, they'd just be showing us what we're being billed.
Yeah, in other words, exactly as you said, details. These are the 496 animals went through. So I expect to see 496 animals came in, ba-boom, ba-boom, in a sheet like that. And I'm not asking the staff to do this. I'll do this. But I think it's, you know, probably something we should, when we pay those kinds of bills, we should have that kind of detail.
Councilman Gardner.
Yeah.
So they don't give us any kind of data when the animal is actually brought in or on the invoice?
No.
Nothing about the animal at all.
You've got mine too, and I just have a question. Where are the meetings? Are they in a city council chamber?
No, they're once a month at the Orange County Animal Shelter.
And I would imagine they don't have any chamber like this or
No, it's not actually a public meeting. And so, as I explained earlier, it's not a Brown Act committee. There are no official decisions made there. It's all recommendations. And so from time to time, I have written summaries of what have happened at those meetings when there's something of a special note that has been put as part of the city manager's update, but I do not do a regular summary of what happens at those meetings.
Mr. Mayor, as the council, there, it's also probably worth noting that not every city who is a member of the county's Animal Control Services is automatically a member of the FOAB. There are seats that are appointed by the City Managers Association based on nominations that occur at those meetings, the managers' meetings, but it's not like Lake Forest has a seat. We happen to have Deborah Rose, who has been appointed by the Managers Association to represent all of the cities, one of several people who do that. So there's several seats, but it's not like there's one from every city that's there. Oftentimes, you might have more who show up, but officially, it's a fairly small number. So just to be sure, this is a staff-level organization and advisory board to the Animal Control Department as well as the Board of Supervisors. So we recommend, I'm not part of the committee, but they make a recommendation to the agency that then takes their items to the board. But we want to be sure about what the membership is. So if you want to talk about the FOAB, let us bring back how it's structured, how it works, so you have a better idea of what that body does and how it's structured.
Mr. Mayor, Council, having gained consensus, I think it's best at this point to cut off discussions so we can have this discussion once it's agendized at a future meeting for Brown Act purposes.
Right. I was just about to say that. I wrote it right down here.
All right, Councilmember Nick.
I often agree with Dr. Gardner because he is who I want to be when I grow old. A very, very wise man, and I mean that facetiously when I say when I grow old. You must understand that my culture, the culture with which I was or in which I was born, glorifies age. Because with age comes wisdom. He is a wise man. I look up to him. I learn from him. And again, hopefully by the time I'm ready to depart this world 50 years from today, I will know half of what he knows. However, I do not agree with him. It was not a good meeting. It was just a meeting. We didn't really accomplish much. Status quo was maintained. It was as if I get up, brush my teeth, eat breakfast, go to work, come home, watch TV, go to sleep. Just another day. Just another meeting. A lot could have happened. A lot could have happened. But it didn't. It didn't because I'm definitely in the minority here. It's not tragic. It's worse than that. We appointed an unqualified individual to the Vector Control Board. And what makes it extremely painfully tragic is that there was this one qualified person. If there was nobody else, if there were nobody else, I would say, well, okay, there is nobody else. But there is somebody else who's actually qualified for the job. I have done all I could have, and I will continue to do what I can to help form this council of people who care for you and for you only. But I cannot do it alone. I count there is 14 of you sitting. For the sake of easy math, let's just say 10. Let's just say there are 10 of you. There's only 10 of you. But if each of you in the days to come reaches out to 10 people to tell them what's been going on here for the number of years now. And if you don't know it, visit the website. It is citizens to end corruption in lakeforest.org. We have some things in there. Not all of it, of course, but some things. Educate yourself. Reach out to 10 people, each of you. That's 100 people. If each of those people reaches to 10 more, that's 1,000. You get it? Pretty soon you're going to have 10,000. That's the number we need. I promise you it can happen. My friends laughed at me when I said I will walk the border. 623 kilometers, it's about 400 miles. 16 years of age, about 115 pounds by myself. Took me 10 months. All I had to remember was what my father said to me. All it takes is the first step. Nothing happens until you take the first step. The greatest journeys begin with the first step, with one step. Take it and keep taking it till you get there. Be relentless. I started on this journey 34 years ago. On the anniversary of my escape from my birth country, I was elected to this office. Those of you who were here know that I did say that, November 6th. To the evening, it was the anniversary of my escape. I came here because this was and is the land of opportunities, where equality matters the most. Where else can you go and accomplish all I have accomplished, personally and professionally? To a great extent, I owe it to you, each and every one of you. I will die one day here. To that day, I will be at your service. I will never lie to you. I will put your interest ahead of my own. If you think my three colleagues to my immediate left have done that, so be it. If you don't think so, do something about it. Thank you.
Councilman Robinson. Mayor Pro Tem Voights.
Everybody had a great holiday season. I wish everybody a healthy and happy and prosperous 2016. Nothing further.
You know, I've got this nice leadership principles here. And number 1.8 is recognize and accept legitimate differences of opinion. We do have differences of opinion up here. And I respect your opinion, Mr. Nick. Also, I wanted to say thank staff for all your work in 2015. If I had a hat, I'd take it off. Want to wish everyone a Happy New Year. Thank you for a good meeting tonight. And also the Amigos de las Colinas, I think I'm saying that right, had a docent volunteer breakfast recognition event, the Heritage Hill, which I attended on Saturday. And it's a great group of volunteers, and they are the ultimate in kindness. So with that, I'd like to seek consensus at staff's bidding to discuss and possibly research becoming a city of kindness, like the city of Anaheim. I actually talked to the mayor of Anaheim today, and he had a lot of great ideas, and I think becoming a city of kindness. And the beauty is, it's not a something that staff has to necessarily spend any time on, and it's something that is more a mindset and something that we can promote as a city. So if I guess I'm seeking consensus.
Yeah, you had mine.
You had mine.
It is a very kind thing to do. Thank you. And last but not least is the unclaimed property notification or website that we could very cheaply produce and post the approximately $6.5 million of unclaimed property owed residents, businesses in Lake Forest, something that would be similar to model URL I'll give you. It's discoveredmoney.org/Lake Forest, and that has many data points on it that show the unclaimed property owed citizens and residents, businesses in Lake Forest, and I'd like to seek consensus to agendize that.
You had mine.
Yeah, mine.
Thank you for your kindness. And with that, I'll adjourn the meeting. Happy New Year.